Hey guys, welcome back to Honey Number X, and today I'm gonna be watching Michael Jackson's Journey from Motown to Off the Wall, which I just listened to. A subscriber recommended that I watch this Off the Wall documentary before Dangerous, and the Bad documentary was really cool. I felt like I got so much insight into him, his thinking process as an artist and all that, but let's just get into Off the Wall. And Motown to Off the Wall. So was Motown what they were part of before? And did he go to another label? I know he was with Sony. But yes, let's get into it. 3, 2, 1. And it's about the same length, or no, it's half of that length. So I think I can finish it all today. Let's hope so. Let's get into it. 3, 2, 1. Yeah, okay. Oh, starting the same way. It's like a Michael Jackson production. Is that why they put it in here?
This is really true. A lot of people say you just made it up to have something to say. But one day our television broke down, and we didn't have anything really to do.
Oh, he's so young here.
But we started doing, started singing. My mother, my brothers, we started making harmony. Next thing we noticed, we were singing in talent shows, winning awards and trophies. That's how it got started.
Aw, he has such a cute smile. Ooh. Ooh, I'm sorry, let me stop. Wow, he sounds amazing. You can hear like little of like Mike, like future Michael in there too. Ooh, who's that brother? Get it. Their style though? Bro.
Come on. They want to hear I Want You Back in ABC and The Love You Save.
Right.
And Dancing Machine and Sugar Daddy, I'll Be There, Got to Be There.
Yeah.
Rock and Robin, you want to hear Daddy's Home? Do you want to hear all the old stuff?
The number one reason I don't want to do the old stuff, number one is old, okay? Number two,
okay.
The choreography is old. Jackie's old.
Wait a minute,
Jackie Bond. Shit. Who's that?
Do
Jackie?
You care? I'll tell you what. I'll do the old stuff for you, okay?
I love his shirt.
But I'm doing it for you. I'm not doing it for them. I'm doing it for you.
Aww. Y'all, stop. I'm gonna cry. This is so cute. Their own cartoon? Bro. Soul Train 72.
Their first four songs.
Very boring.
Broke historical records because they all
first
went to number
four?
One. The very first four songs. They ever recorded.
That was their
which was,
first four?
I Want You Back.
ABC, The Love You Save.
Then I'll Be There.
What happened after that
That's
was
insane.
We went from being able to go anywhere, get a hamburger, go to a movie, you know, go shopping, to being able to go nowhere. They became
oh,
so
yeah, they was on TV.
So quickly that
so
none
people
of us
would come
prepared.
Straight to you. They couldn't get you nowhere else, huh? That must have been crazy.
He used to sing songs with a lot of feeling, and he would sing them with a lot of feeling
Catherine
and a
Jack-
lot of
oh,
mood,
this
like
is his
he
mom.
Had been here before, like he had lived it before.
Vocally, he was just leaps and bounds ahead of what anybody could teach him. He came here knowing that stuff. It was in his DNA.
I discovered that Michael was very talented when he was just about 2 or 3 years old.
Wow.
Michael had a lot of rhythm, and he loved to dance.
You can tell.
I think he was born dancing.
Michael told me way back, he said, Steve, I'm not going to be poor. Imagine 11 kids living in a two-bedroom house.
11? I'm sorry.
Indiana's no Beverly.
11?
It's hard. When you have all those kids like I had, and you kids, you know, they like to eat, so when they holler, they want some food, you got to put something in their hand. And I kept food on the table, plenty of food, Spike.
Joseph had done a remarkable job creating the group.
I can remember.
So the dad was the leader of the group?
Particularly Michael, to make it.
Managing?
I would say, to this day, Motown was the greatest school for me. Really, it was the best. I learned how to cut a track as well as producing. I've done so
wow, like well. Actually being pretty part of the production too. That's really cool. Marlon and Jackie.
Everything. And we learned so much about lyrical content, how to produce songs.
Jackie sounds about the same.
Being a great artist. They had the best songwriters and artists in the world.
Here we are in Chicago. You see here members of the Temptations down here on the bottom.
I've heard of the Temptations.
This little Michael with his afro.
Aww.
And I'm right next to him. That's me, y'all.
What Michael learned is to be great, you had to be persistent. You had to work. You got to watch people like Diana Ross, Martin Gaye.
I didn't realize. I thought they were like the same age for the longest time, y'all.
Smokey Robinson and all those wonderful guys that we idolized.
And these were legends in the music industry that he was able
to observe. Yeah, they were huge. They're still like known, well known today.
I got my degree. University.
It was really an atmosphere of competition. Competition breeds champions, but you can't let the competition overcome the love. And so it was all built on love, and Michael was full of love. And the atmosphere just suited him very well.
We learned so much being with all those great songwriters and producers.
And at the time when it's taking place, you don't realize that.
When we were kids ourselves, I didn't know
when you're in it.
And we were learning as
look at him
we
with the sound. Oh, he's so cute. Getting that footwork.
It's the same nerve the Beatles touched low these many years ago.
What's that song?
Only this time
I
it's
swear
a
they just performed. Is it I Want You Back? That's the one?
By an 11-year-old soul brother.
Aw, he's only 11 here.
It was so intense. My fan worship. You have to understand that all the kids who were responding to the Jackson 5 hadn't had a Mickey Mouse Club with kids like them on camera. They represented the first youth group of our contemporary times for all these kids to identify with. And initially, they were all the black kids.
The beginning is, you know, when I first saw him, and that's the reason why I'm here.
Oh, that's Lee Daniels. I love Empire.
He wanted me to do whatever it is that I'm doing right
now. Lucia's toxic, but
everything that,
it's so entertaining.
That I aspired to be.
Well, boys, they practice most of the
I know
time.
He does a lot of music that's in his show.
One of the kids was out there. Running the streets and playing. It was in there trying to get a song down or something.
He wanted to be the best at everything he ever did. We're not at all concerned about the working. We work all day and all night.
I mean, this kid at 9 meant serious business. I mean, this kid meant serious, serious business. I mean, he was not kidding.
He questioned Nick and I about our early Motown songs, you know. He always wanted to know, how'd you come up with this idea? What was this? What made you say that? You know, songs like Ain't Nothing Like the Real Thing. He was a real student.
I was fascinated by the fact that he had this kind of
Sammy
commitment
Davis Jr.
and this kind of dedication and was inquisitive.
Oh, okay, I've heard of the Rat Pack. That's cool.
He'd always be watching.
Well, who else do you think makes the stage come to real life besides me and Ed Sullivan?
Hold it. You're beginning to see
me,
kid.
That
dress is so pretty.
Best experience in the world. Just sitting on the wings and learning.
Look at him. Oh, my God.
And he would sit with me at mixing sessions because I did a lot of mixing. He would sit there for hours and hours. I would tell somebody, one of my assistants, I'd say, well, my back is turned, but
he looked like he could be related to them. Like,
the thing I loved about Motown was that
a Berry Gordy, if he didn't like a song, he'd go in the studio and cut one himself. And so Berry Gordy, in my opinion, is probably the greatest record man that ever was.
Berry was wonderful at taking a song. That's really cool.
Like, he's really involved in his work.
Giving it the right flavors to make it a hit. He knew just what it, you know, what it takes, and everybody can't do that.
Where Willard ended, then begins.
That's the one I was supposed to listen to, y'all.
From Cinerama releasing, and this time, he's not alone.
And then came Ben, which was a soundtrack to a movie about rats.
Oh.
Remember we toured, the whole world demanded to hear. We can't get off stage.
Everyone watched a rap movie for him, bro.
Performance of Ben.
That would literally be me.
1973. Rats. The first time Michael really stepped out on his own.
The first nominated song,
I would go for him.
Ben, from the picture Ben. It'll be sung by a young man whose talent is mature, but whose age suggests that maybe he shouldn't even be up this late.
Ben, the two of us need no more.
Whew. So easy, so smooth.
He was part of your whole
life. I want to listen to that, y'all. I'm going to listen to that.
When you were a little kid with all the Jackson 5 songs.
He looked familiar.
And when you're a little older, then through your puberty, your adolescence.
Being your life is running here and there.
And then when you go to college, and then he was always around, defining a part of your life.
There's so many steps in between that first day and Off the Wall. For me, the most heartbreaking was when they left Motown.
Oh, they gotta stretch their wings. What's the song, y'all? They performed this at the...
They came in as bubblegum.
That lady's show.
No one ever graduates from being a cute kid group to being taken seriously.
There's no child singer that you can point to besides Michael Jackson that went from being really big to the biggest pop star ever.
Thank God for Dance Machine.
I'm trying to think of it. You better work. Woo! Break the neck. Hey.
What they were observing at the time at Motown, what the Jacksons were observing, were a lot of the artists having creative freedom.
Which is really not a thing now, huh?
We wanted to write. We wanted to produce ourselves. Okay, so what is it? And our contract in Motown didn't let us do that.
Oh, wow. They wanted a lot of control over stuff. That's still true today.
Two guys named Ron Alexenberg and Steve Popovich. Okay, and they were with Epic. One was head of promotion, one was head of A&R. And they came to me and said, we're going to sign the Jacksons, you know, as a group.
It all started at the Warwick Hotel, and there's nothing but kids around the whole hotel. I went to the doorman, and I said, what's going on here? And he said, the Jackson 5 are here. And it gave me the opportunity to go, just the way I am, into the lobby. I picked up the house phone, and I called, and I said, Michael Jackson, please. And they rang right through to room 805. He came downstairs.
Imagine.
And I looked at him and I said, Jackson, what do you want to do? And he said, someday I'd like to do my own music. I said, really? What about now?
The group wanted to leave Motown. Joseph thought that he wanted to bring them and take them to a whole other level that Motown just couldn't do.
But I was told not to sign them. And I was told that they were a cartoon act. And I went
cartoon
to Walter Yetnikoff, who was my boss, and I said,
these hits ain't saying so at all.
This label. We call ourselves the family of music.
Y'all love
money.
This
is a family. I want to sign.
I said, well, I don't know how many records they've sold. So I went to hear at the Westbury Music Fair. Michael was 15 years old at the time. He's singing a song to a dead rat, which you remember, named Ben. Okay, and I come back and I said to these guys, are you crazy? I was signing, we're going to give him $3.5 million.
It's about a rat?
You know, you're new in your
job. I mean, I know it's a soundtrack to a movie about rap, but
I was in the job like 3 weeks when that happened.
I was like, okay, I'll go along with you guys. You seem to know what you're doing.
I said, you know, you're probably right. That was my brilliant move in signing the Jacksons.
Okay. pretty, so pure, his sound.
The most tense time of life for me was the changing from Motown to CBS. I was in a whole nother world. I didn't know what was happening.
Understanding the challenge of
Kobe,
a child prodigy, having to make the transition. Now being serious.
I'm not into basketball like that.
How much courage it takes to actually step out.
I know the impact he had on the game. Like, he's
come with a new sound.
Rest in peace.
Pretty damn scary.
I don't want to go over what he's saying. I don't want to go and disrespect him like that. I'm going to go back 20 seconds, y'all.
I didn't know what was happening.
Understanding the challenge of a child prodigy having to make a transition. Now being a serious, serious artist, how much courage it takes to actually step outside of that and to come with a new sound. That could be pretty damn scary.
Kind of a critical decision that...
That was a kind of random interview.
...with her father, Joe Jackson, made to leave Motown.
But still appreciate it.
Resulted in a lawsuit, out of which came a name change to the Jacksons.
I was told I couldn't use the name Jackson 5, and I said, it's okay, we'll call them the Jacksons.
Very good. Oh, because
we were all...
How are you going to be that petty?
Was gone.
How are you... Let people go. It just...
Jermaine Jackson was married to the daughter of Berry Gordy, so probably not a good idea for him to leave Motown with the rest of his family.
We respect Jermaine's decision because that was a very difficult decision for him to make. And I respect him for that because he did what he wants to do. I want people to do what they want to do. Don't do what I want you to do. Do what you feel that's best for you.
I like that.
So much going on, so much tension. I wasn't sure what was going to happen.
I asked Michael, what's going to happen when people ask you, why are you leaving Motown? And he said, because everything is possible with you at Epic Records. There's nothing more to be said.
And with Columbia Records, we want to sell twice as many records. We want to do the things that we've dreamed of.
It was not a popular signing in the business, nor was it in the building. Ron's lost his mind. You know, the Jacksons have had it. They're done.
The problem at that time is they had had a cartoon series, and the credibility was questionable.
Because they did a cartoon series? That's hitting a different market. You understand? Hitting the target market.
I'm going to give them as much credibility as I possibly can.
We got on the train, went to Philadelphia. Gamble and Huff opened their drawer full of hits.
When you think of disco and when you think of quality disco, you came to Philadelphia.
Two of the people that Michael Jackson learned from immensely were Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff, who were the creators and entrepreneurs behind Philly International.
The proprietors of the disco sound.
They had always wanted to write and produce their own records, you know what I mean, and be a part of the process. And that's pretty much what Philly International was. It was a place where you had a lot of creative freedom.
They wrote tons of hits, I mean, tons of hits.
We had Al Melvin and the Blue Notes, we had the OJs.
Go through the roster.
We had Patti LaBelle.
Archie Bell, the Drells.
I know Patti LaBelle.
Billy Paul.
Lou Rawls, we had Teddy Pendergrass.
3 Degrees.
3 Degrees. We had to style these songs to fit these guys' voices.
And that's what great producers do, right?
Sure. Well,
we're cool. Right almost in the middle of a recording session with the Jacksons. And guess who is producing their brand new album? Gamble and Huff.
That's right.
Now, why would you guys come all the way in from California to cut some sides in an album in Philadelphia?
Because Gamble and Huff organization is here, and they're two of the best producers in the world.
Working with Gamble and Huff, they do it in a little quicker pace. It takes 3 weeks to make a record. I didn't know you can make a record in 3 weeks, a whole album.
Oh, wow.
They were the Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis of the 70s.
And Michael always says that he learned a lot about the songwriting process from Kenny Gamble and Leon Huff, how to structure a song, how to create great arrangements.
The Jacksons came to Philadelphia for 2 years to record two records, the Jacksons and Going Places.
We try to write songs that people do all the time, or people say things all the time. Enjoy yourself, enjoy yourself with me. People say that all the time, so, you know, enjoy yourself.
That's cool, that's a cool strategy. Big ass, these sparkly suits. I'm living. How many were them as Jacksons?
He was driven by the music. He loved the music, and
you're gonna learn.
One of the most important things to being successful is listening. It's listening and watching, and being a good person to work with, easy to work with.
Every song is a negotiation. Every production is a negotiation if you're co-doing it with someone.
You know, the producer wanted me to pronounce words a certain way.
There was a song, and there's a line in it where he sings.
Now I'm a man that's for all seasons. And where the city offers me ain't naturally.
Ain't naturally sings that. And I go, oh, no, that's bad English. So I say, hang on, Mike. And I come out, and I said, so it's like, isn't naturally, or isn't natural.
I told him you pronounce the word so precisely it takes away from the feeling.
Exactly, you don't gotta pronounce every single thing. Just feel it.
There's a lot of give and take, and sometimes you don't want to give. Or sometimes you give, but you feel like I should have left it the way it was.
Something said in my brain, shut the fuck up. Stop being the grammar police. This guy's a genius.
To himself, I was gonna say, I'm sorry. I was going to say, talking about pronouncing that. Are we
you
at school?
You want to 100% express your idea. It's just 100% expression of me.
We have two singles on the album coming out in December on Epic. First time we've written some songs on the album.
It was a different style, but still it was a hit record. So when we started putting that together with what we heard amongst the brothers, it created our own style.
That's cool.
It's time to write. Something lets you know that it's time for you to go out and do it yourself. So we decided to write and produce our own songs. And we finally did. And we went through so much, you know.
I mean, I feel like, how are you going to teach someone how to
get
in the production, learn all this training, and not want to be involved in the music making process, you know?
I felt it was something that came within from us, and this is... This is the Jacksons. This is us today.
On the Destiny album, which is the album that comes out in 1978, a year prior to Off the Wall, he's starting to make those moves. He wrote Shake Your Body Down to the Ground.
Where were you when you first heard about that record? How'd it happen?
He was at home, and Randy was playing this groove on the piano. Mm-hmm. Da, da, da. I said, what is that? He said, oh, it's nothing. I said, don't say that. It is something. And I just started singing to his playing, and it came about.
Randy played
instruments. Some of my friends out here that I had a lot of respect for that knew how to arrange. I thought the key to really making an album of a vocal band like this is obviously great musicians, great arrangements.
Bobby Columbia convinced me that I should get more into arranging.
Dang, he said, you touched everything that was lit.
And next thing you know, I'm in a room with the Jacksons.
Then we brought Greg in.
Why he look so young?
Destiny album again. Man, shoot.
Amazing. Everybody was using Greg Kirkland.
It was soup then.
When I first heard the demo for Shake Your Body, it was, you know, obviously the melody was there, which was very strong, and they had the basic piano part, you know, that you hear the dun, 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 all that rhythm was there.
Walk around the tunnel with your head on the sky, but I do your best.
Oh, they're so cute.
But there wasn't as much going on rhythmically.
Greg came up with it.
Damn, y'all know it.
Like, that's the rhythm of Shake Your Body Down to the Ground, which the average song was more like...
It fit perfectly.
At first, when he came up with that beat, I said, what is this guy doing? And I said that to myself. I didn't say anything, but I waited till he played it. And man, when he played it, and we heard it in the record, I said, oh my God, this is the bomb. Because I'd never heard a beat like that before, you know, and it was incredible. Great beat.
I said, if the Jacksons ever need a drummer, let them know your friend is in town. The guy's name is James McPhail, keyboard player who got me the audition. And Tito said that. He had his arm on his guitar, and he said, let's play Shake Your Body Down, like this kind of
look. Is Tito
You know that one?
Guitarist?
I start playing the beat.
Is Tito one of the brothers?
And they're looking at each other.
Who's Tito?
Whispering each other's ear. And they like looking, and I'm like saying, oh no, I'm blowing it. Because that beat is very tricky. You have to know when and how to cross your arms to make the toms happen, the intricate hi-hat happen, and keep the beat going without losing any of the elements. And then Randy, he said, nobody could play that beat. That was a three-part overdub. And I said, really? I said, I thought the guy played it one time. And they were shocked and amazed I could play it. And he said,
oh, wow. You're a drummer. Okay, you proved yourself.
Doing the horn arrangements, who is a horn arranger out of Chicago who did all the Earth, Wind, and Fires.
I've heard of them. They were big.
Earth, Wind, and Fire horn players to come in and play. I mean, horn players love that beat.
It's as dissonant and tension-provoking a verse musically. You can't, and I'm like, what's going on? Where's the bridge? Where's the solo? When are we? I'm just used to other form. Epic's really not interested in them at all at this point. It was kind of like, oh God, we gotta put this out. I get a call from Paris Ely. He's head of promotion for the R&B department. And he says, hey man, Shake Your Body's a hit.
I want to show you, first of all, the album, and then show you the inside, if I may, and from left to right. They are Randy and Tito and Jackie and Marlon and Michael, and they are the Jacksons.
That's a sick-ass cover. Hey! I want to wear his outfit. Like, it's really nice. Who's the one crisscrossing? He's getting it.
That enabled people to see Michael Jackson finally as an adult.
Because it was musical. It was a long way from ABC, and I Want You Back.
So it's like a more mature sound for him? And they would take it more seriously. So sparkly.
There's a moment in the demo of Shake Your Body Down to the Ground which clearly let me know that they had their eyes on a bigger prize. It's 1978, and the biggest selling album of all time is Saturday Night Fever.
What the heck's that?
And there's a moment that you can hear Jackie in the background say, I can't wait till the Bee Gees hear this shit.
I want the Bee Gees to hear this shit.
Bee Gees? What?
We wrote, produced by the Jacksons, all songs written by the Jacksons. Well, Mick Jackson, a white kid that lived in England, wrote Blame It on the Boogie. He didn't lie. His name is Jackson.
Don't you blame it on the sunshine. Don't blame it on the moonlight. Don't blame it on good times. I just can't control my feet. Who added this? Okay, it's getting too much of an ad. Sunshine. Don't blame it on the moonlight. Don't blame it on the good times. Boy, disco vibe was really like very present in his album. Hey, kick it.
So Michael starts singing. He throws the headphones down and bolts out of the studio. I turned to the engineer. Did he get feedback? Did something? He goes, no, nothing. I go out to the hall. He's dancing. It was unbelievable. He's spinning around. He goes, I'm sorry. He said, I can't stand still and sing that section. I got to get this out.
He had watched James Brown, the Nicholas Brothers, and Sammy Davis.
He can see somebody dance one time, like Freddie Stair and some of those other stars. And he can do just exactly what they easy to catch
wow.
on.
Jackie Wilson. Talk about dancing genius.
On the wings every day, stage. We would play at the Riga Theater six Ooh, shows a day. We were
ankles?
Oh my God.
I felt my ankles out. Literally yeah. collapse from that. Davis Jr. He was getting it.
You can't go wrong watching Sammy Davis Jr.
Yeah.
To watch him and to see and suddenly see little flashes. Flatteringly, I say this about myself, little flashes of me there and go, wow, but he's extended it. He's changed it. He's colored it till it becomes his own.
That's what we love.
They introduced me to Fred Astaire and all these movies, and I had no idea who the hell these people were prior to that. Right?
I know, who the hell these people were?
He just, you know, he opened up my eyes to a whole nother world of inspiration.
I just want to let you know, I have all your films on tape, and I watch them all the time.
Oh, Fred Astaire.
And I want to ask you one question.
Yeah.
How do you do that thing when you walk on
was
the ceiling?
Was it Smooth Criminal? He said he really liked it.
How did that work?
The whole room really and the camera turned.
So they both turned, right?
Yeah.
The whole room and the camera turned? Wow, that is so cool. They're literally imitating that now, like on TikTok and stuff like that. That's insane when you don't have all the tricks we can do now. Ooh, y'all better tap dance. What the? I know y'all could tap dance. Ooh. It's just so
Michael
satisfying.
Michael's dance is based on energy, and he's
Gene Kelly.
He moves like an electric eel. He's got, I think the adjective electric is good
yes.
for him. He's charged with energy, but he has a good inner sense, or wherever it comes from, his brain, wherever. To just take it down and then up again quickly, which good dancers naturally have. I came out after the war, after I was in the Navy, and I wanted to dance the common man. I didn't want to dance in white tie or tuxedo and dressed up. I wanted to roll up my sleeves and wear jeans and t-shirts. And the nearest thing I could get to dancing shoes were
his,
loafers.
His name
and
sounds
and
so familiar,
socks,
y'all.
And the rolled up jeans. And he's dancing from the streets, like I was. I believe that.
I was a teenager and I was getting older. I started to really understand the power of dance.
Am I tripping? Is she from Birds of Prey?
Stop on a dime.
The cop?
With such intensity, that's the power I'm talking about.
And I perfect a certain amount of moves. There is beauty and simplicity. And really stripping things down. And I learned that from him. He impacted everything for me, absolutely. He impacted my game on the court. He impacted
wow, he impacted his
day,
game on the court.
Watching him was like something I'd never seen before. It was something that was magical, that was creative, that seemed like something that I could mimic. That's how I found my love for dance before I found classical ballet.
I used to ask him, how much did you practice? He said, I would dance until I can't dance no more. I said, what do you mean? It's my, I danced to my legs. I physically could not move.
There's a lot of people who just don't have that same type of drive. You see it in an artist like
oh,
Beyonce.
Oh, she did. Remember the time. That was awesome.
You know, a lot of times when it comes
Shout
to black
to Beyonce
artists,
too.
It happens with Basquiat, it happens with Miles Davis, with Michael Jackson. People talk about their kind of natural gifts as if there's not strategy and skill.
Tell
and
it.
As if Miles Davis didn't go to Juilliard, or Basquiat didn't know who Monet and Renoir were, or Michael Jackson hadn't been doing this his entire life.
Some of my favorite writers are Johnny Mercer, Irving Berlin, George Gershwin, Duke Ellington, Count Basie.
No, you gotta put the work in, man. You gotta put the time in. And really, man, it's love that you're putting in. You know, because people that do this kind of stuff, man, we love what we do.
You have to.
This is dated November 6, 1979. He was on the road with his brothers on the Destiny Tour. MJ will be my new name. No more Michael Jackson. I want a whole new character, a whole new look. I should be a totally different person. People should never think of me as the kid who sang ABC, I Want You Back. I should be a new, incredible actor, singer, dancer that will shock the world. I will do no interviews. I will be magic. I will be a perfectionist, a researcher, a trainer, a master. I will be better than every great actor roped in one. I must have the most incredible training system to dig and dig and dig until I find. I will study and look back on the whole world of entertainment and perfect it. Take it steps further from where the greatest left off.
You guys are really riding a big high now as far as producing records and so on. Do you think this is the peak of your career now? Or have you gone down a little bit? Are you expecting bigger and better things? What are you looking forward to in the future?
I didn't know he impacted so many.
Recording other artists and going into acting. We get a lot of scripts in, but we haven't found the exact script that we want to use. So we're picking and deciding.
I think you may be a big movie star one day.
Yeah, I'd like to give it a try. Yeah,
it's good business to get. You got the looks, you know. Fortunately, I didn't, what?
With the advent of motion pictures came an abundance of Oz films. A 1925 version starred Oliver Hardy as the Tin.
Yeah, I just looked it up casually and he was there. I was like, what the heck?
MGM,
I think I've seen it when I was young. I, like, saw
In 1974, The Wiz opened on Broadway, winning 7 Tony Awards.
Dorothy was black?
I was a senior in high school.
Bro.
And there was this girl named Barbara Hampton who I liked. And I wanted to impress her. I was working at Baskin Robbins.
I love Baskin Robbins.
I just saved my money. I finally got up enough courage to ask her, would you like to go see The Wiz with me? I got 2 great seats at Center Aisle. She said, nah, I don't think
so. Girl. Girl.
Scalped them for double the price.
I took Michael the first time.
At least you got your money.
More times.
The Wiz, when it came out in 1978, was the, you know, Lamette's movie adaptation of that great long-running play that was on Broadway with Stephanie Mills.
I didn't know The Wiz, like, literally started out with a black character.
There was a great debate, at least in my neighborhood, that Diana Ross is dope, but the only reason why they cast is because she's Diana Ross. Stephanie Mills would have been a better fit for the film, but for whatever reason, she didn't get the job.
We're not going to do it with an unknown young actress.
I don't know, y'all.
We have to have the star power to make it cross over.
I get
it. Over.
I get it.
It also was the most expensive
Could she act?
Movie ever made with an all African American cast.
So because of
I get
car
it. Sometimes it's just like that.
And Sparkle, and you know this happens in Hollywood, mm-hmm. where you designate as the go-to guy for black material.
Oh, it's the Black Rider.
The Black Rider, huh?
And Sidney was probably the number one American director right then, because he had done Serpico, Dog Day Afternoon, Network, Murder on the Orient Express, I think all in a row. He was king,
right?
And definitely king of New York.
Michael was desperate to play the Scarecrow.
Always wanted to have a film career. There was some rumor that he was supposed to star in the Frankie Lyman story that never happened. The Wiz was supposed to be a huge film. Diana Ross, his longtime pal, is starring in it.
He's no longer in Motown, and Michael called Berry Gordy.
We were doing The Wiz. Rob Korn was handling it. He was working for me at the time with Motown Productions.
It would have been very easy for him to say, well, you know, Michael, you're gone now. And
hell,
that would have been petty as hell.
Sidney was adamant that he didn't want Michael. He felt Michael was over and had been a cute little kid, musical star, but hadn't grown into it. And I just said, you're making a mistake. And I want you to meet him. Of course, Lumet fell in love with Michael.
Of course.
Michael may be the purest talent I've ever seen. He's incapable of a false moment. He's so true that anything around him has to become true. Or if you don't work honestly around him, you're going to look as if you're faking it.
Well, yeah, he's all those things. Plus, this kid can dance and sing like nobody else.
It was so obvious, the genius of this boy. I mean, it was so effortless.
When I was real small and I saw the original Wizard of Oz, the Judy
Garland.
Judy
Garland. Yeah, that one.
I always fell in love with the Scarecrow. I think most kids do because you feel sorry for him and everything. And he's so, his character. And I always watched them. Matter of fact, I had the step down they did when I was around 6. I would do it all around the house. Follow the yellow brick road.
Ta-da! Woo! Come on, Dorothy! Come on!
Come on then, ease on down, ease on down the road. Come on, ease on down, ease on down the road.
Oh, they did new music for it too.
Matter of matter of fact, that hill that we do ease on down the road was going uphill. And Diana and me, we were so out of breath, we had to do it a couple of times, really. I mean, it was going straight up.
It does kind of look inclined. Don't you give up walking, don't you give up shooting. She's doing that in heels, bro, girl. I would have been
makeup
on the floor.
In the morning, get the makeup out of the way. Right on the
case. Is that a Reese's Pieces? Y'all.
Lines, everybody's songs. He knew everybody's position.
Just the whole Reese's Pieces on his nose.
And I saw this uncanny type discipline in such a young person.
Quincy, of course, was the musical director. He was doing the score for The Wiz.
And you see him for a minute, right? You see
don't
him
drink
for a minute
water.
Conducting the band in the movie. And I was a Quincy fan. You know, Smackwater Jack, Walking in Space, Body Heat, all that stuff. The Wiz seemed like a great combination of all these things that he could do.
Lumet was very happy to have Quincy. We all were. That just kind of guaranteed the musical portion would hit a strong popular chord.
He didn't have actually have a feature number in the film when they hired him. They didn't know about the dancing or a lot of things.
They was not checking for him?
Eventually, everybody came to understand what he was all about.
You can't win. Maybe he was not as big as I thought he was during this time.
Things are gonna change, but they look just like they stay in the same. But I don't think they showed enough of his dancing.
The real night that Off the Wall was born, we were doing the pre-records for the movie. Quincy had like tunnel vision on Diana Ross. Finally, about 2 a.m., Q had what he wanted from Diana, and he goes, okay, Michael, you come in on R6, and Michael starts like at 1,000 watts. And he's doing everything that became the signature Michael Jackson. Woo! Ah!
Oh, wow. Oh,
come on, Dorothy! Come on!
And it was like a lioness who just suddenly sees a baby goat.
The more I knew him, and the more I became fascinated with the idea of maybe working with him.
It was a lot of fun working with all the greats, Sidney Lumet, Quincy Jones, everybody.
I may be, I don't know, one of the few people who really love The Wiz. There's some great representation on film that we had seen before.
When The Wiz came out, I was 7 years old.
It must
that
have
was
been
an event for bro. Black
yeah.
America. I can't speak for all of New York City, I can't speak for all of the country. But everybody in my neighborhood in Harlem was going to see The Wiz because of Mike Jackson.
So this is a big moment for Michael Jackson. He gets to fulfill his acting desires, and he's finally in a big Hollywood film. So he and his sister LaToya moved to New York.
I found him an apartment on 456th Street.
That's his other sister.
In the summer
LaToya.
Of 77.
I see LaToya.
A legendary summer.
She was on, I think she was on Masked Singer. She was really good on there.
Sam, who's doing all these random killings.
Bitch, he was out killing people during this time.
It was the time in which all of these nascent music forms were coming up. Punk, hip-hop, disco
was
huge. And there were all these different elements that were happening in New York at the same time that were sort of coming in contact with each other.
Can't we do like a hip-hop?
I have a feeling that's probably where he first heard a lot of early hip-hop. The beatboxing that he's basically doing on a song like Working Day and Night. Even though he's only 19, he was going to Studio 54 on a regular basis.
Perhaps you've heard the name Studio 54. It attracts the rich and the famous, the glamorous and the powerful. They come to this disco palace in New York City just about any night of the week.
He was making all kinds of eccentric and unusual friends that, you know, now we see the photos of and it looks really strange. He's hanging out with Liza
Minnelli.
Woody
Allen.
Just hanging out in New
York?
Studio 54.
I come here a lot?
Oh, God, yes.
Why?
Because I like the atmosphere of Studio 54. I've been to a lot of discotheques and I don't like them. Honestly.
What's the difference?
I don't know, the feeling. I mean, the excitement of the props coming down and the balcony. It's just exciting.
They gotta put a lot of money into it.
I'm certain that his experience and going to Studio 54 during the filming of The Wiz played a big part in where he wanted this album played. And it doesn't mean that he wanted to make a disco record. He is a dancer. He's a marvelous dancer. He's an influential, innovative dancer.
Well, why do you dance for fun?
Because you're just being free then. Most of the time it's set choreography when we're on stage, it's stuff you have to do every night. When you dance here, you're just free, you dance with whoever you want to, you just go, I mean, you just go wild.
What about the craziness? It gets crazy and wild. And...
What goes on here?
No, not only is it fun to dance, it's fun to look at, you know, other people. You walk around and you see all kind of things. Like Darth Vader was here the other night. It was incredible.
I'm sure he was making these observations of what was going on around him. He was kind of self-conscious about himself and kind of shy. So he wasn't trying to be around all of the wildness, all of the freakness. You know what I'm saying? He would go in a DJ booth and just watch people and make these mental notes, and I'm sure musical notes also.
And I think all of that shows up on Off the Wall because it's certainly one of the most sensual albums he ever released. It contains this sort of exuberance in the sexuality.
It's where you come when you want to escape. Mm. It's really escapism.
Mm. We left Motown. You know, a certain amount of albums for the Jacksons and a certain amount for me
for
as
contracts.
A solo artist.
He's coming out as an autonomous figure, separate from his father, separate from his brothers, and really establishing himself as a solo act.
I called him up one day. I said, do you know anybody who could do, you know, produce that? Because I knew I had songs that I wanted to do. I didn't really want, I mean, I wasn't asking him to do it. And he said, sure. And he's only going to do it. That's a great idea.
I mean, there was some speculation, you know, would Quincy be the right guy? He's a jazz guy. Would he be, you know?
They didn't think that he can make a contemporary hit record that everybody.
So that's like, that was a challenge for Quincy, too?
I don't think it is possible to sit down and try to intellectualize and theorize about how you can make a record that can appeal to many, many people. The people in this room, you know, it's very difficult to try to make a record that everybody
That's
in this room
true.
Would like.
Not
the label
gonna
had
like
other ideas
put
about
out.
Who he should go with. They wanted Maurice White was one of the people, and they
Ooh.
Also wanted Gamble and Huff to work with him. Michael came back all teary-eyed one day and said, the people at Epic don't want to use you. They said, you're too jazzy, you know, you don't understand this kind of music.
But they don't know. You know, these guys don't know. The A&R men, they don't know.
Thank God he went back and he and with Frederick the Man and Ron Weisner, and they fought and they said he's doing it.
Quincy
Good.
Called me one
he advocated
day and
for
said,
himself.
We're going to do Michael Jackson's album, his first solo album. And I thought to myself, holy cow, I better get serious. Because I don't get those kind of calls very often.
When you discover Off the Wall for the first time, forget all the music for a second. Let's just
Mary
talk
J.
about
Blige,
the
Destiny Child, and Beyonce.
The sound of it.
Wait.
The sonic of that album stands.
I'm gonna go back.
For the first time,
Ronnie
forget
Jenkins.
All
okay.
the music for okay. a second. Let's just talk about the sonics, the sound of it. The sonic of that album stands up against any album right now, period.
Because it's raw. It was before drum machines, before.
Why all the black people on here have clear ass skin? Like,
it's
where are y'all going?
Today,
like, what are you using for your skin? Like, I need to know.
We had live
clear.
Live drummer.
That way you get magic. You know, you get a little bit of magic.
Oh, live.
If somebody's live playing just a little bit under or something like that, that's all part of making the record breathe.
That's a pulse.
It's pulse. It's like, yeah, it's a pulse. Yeah, it's, but today everything is right on. Today
because
is
they
right
quantize
on.
Every damn thing.
Everything is right on today.
These were like living, breathing recordings that were for the dance floor. Machines are great.
Yeah, I know it. I know her.
Incredible musicians, I feel like, who beat it every time.
I'm always telling engineers, like, you better study and listen. If they were able to accomplish that type of fullness and that type of sound, they're able to do that, then you better be able to do something great now.
Tell it.
What Quincy has
tell
is extraordinary history. He's leading the band behind Count Basie.
Working with Frank Sinatra.
Sammy Davis Jr.
Pawnbroker.
Heat of the Night.
Sanford and Son. Studied in France under a great orchestration.
That's that one song.
Nadia Boulanger, who taught Ravel.
He's unlimited musical. You can, you want anything, he can do it. Jazz, folk, pop, classical.
Not this.
Soul,
stash.
Gospel, anything.
Michael wrote three songs on
Looking
the Off
like,
the Wall album.
What's his name?
Don't Stop Till You Get Enough. Working
Charlie
Day and Night, and
Chaplin.
Get on the Floor. You wanted
Charlie
the freedom
Chaplin.
To develop as an artist, and writing these three songs was very important to him. The demos are kind of a revelation in that they really illuminate Michael's abilities as a songwriter and show how developed these songs were when he brought them to Quincy Jones. You really see Michael's rhythmic sophistication.
Dun, 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 dun.
That's what did it.
Boom, boom, dun, 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 dun.
That's the phrase that pays. That's the hook right there. Michael ain't gotta say a word yet. They can play that bass line and they can run it nonstop. and we're good.
The opening bars of that record.
Yeah, sometimes I'm like, bro, you didn't even need anything else. Just the instrumental would have just been fire.
It's just like, ah! You kind of get this little tick, you know, that's going on. Anybody that you're around, you know, they're just down for it. Even the guys try to be hard, like, you know, you just in
y'all stop trying to act hard. Just dance.
You keep on because the force has got a lot of power, and the power, and it make me feel like it make me feel like it.
Bro, this violin go crazy.
Song I use to reset my day. It's the song that I use when I need to be motivated. Wow. It's my absolute favorite Michael Jackson song.
These are my own songs. I'm gonna communicate my own emotions, my
favorite
own ideas,
gotta be like Rock With You or Burn This Disco Out. Like those two are my top on the album.
I mean, you hear a lot of that in these songs, completely uninhibited. You feel his energy coming through because you feel that freedom.
And that's the first time we heard that iconic yell. That's his free at last, free at last.
I was in Buffalo with you. Fantastic show. You darn near blinded me there, man. That thing is dynamite when you come out. They have to see that. You jumping out of there.
Oh, don't stop.
Whoa. Ooh, he said, I'm taking your sight.
Don't Stop Till You Get Enough had this kind of this opening groove, right? And the opening groove kind of sets you off. If you were a dancer, you know, you let that sink in.
I always use Michael as
Weekend.
First and foremost as a vocal
inspiration. This is what he was doing there.
And Off the Wall is definitely the music. One that made me feel like I could sing. I found my falsetto because of Off the Wall. Don't Stop Till You Get Enough.
Yes! I love Weekend falsetto. It's the feeling. So nice because it's like he has so much control, you know?
And had these bizarre lyrics, well, to me, these bizarre lyrics that were quoting Star Wars.
I didn't even know he was saying keep on with the forks.
So it was stop. Star Wars reference.
When I was a kid, I was just like, keep on with the forks. I didn't know what the forks were.
I know where I have just watched Star Wars, and then I heard that song, and I was like, is this about Star Wars? And he just talked about Darth Vader, so I think he's a fan. Hey! The small, like, dance moves are just so addictive. Hey! Doesn't miss a single beat. It's just so satisfying. Ooh, ankle. Ooh, you better. So check out my socks. Or no, are those leg warmers? I don't know. Okay, he's leaping. He's doing ballet shit right now. Hey. Oh, we're going through the tracks. Rock With You. This is my shit.
You know, you just look like $1 million.
Yes.
You know?
I love that video.
I think that's before you had $1 million to spend, too.
Right.
So it was done for relatively a small amount of money. Yeah, and he had to single-handedly sell it.
What is the mix that they use, like, when he performs live? Because it sounds different. It sounds... We can ride the boogie, share that beat of love. I'm gonna rock with you all night.
It just gives late night vibes.
That was the skater's anthem. There was a skate obsession in the United States in 79, 80, where it was like,
I thought it was skateboarding, y'all. But I can see it. I can see it.
It should feel like the floor to your skates. It should be the foundation for all of that flowing. Just take it slow.
Bridge. I'd always mix up heat and beat on this song, y'all. Bro, I'm gonna listen to this after this. No, I said bring it to me.
Rock With You seemed like there was symbolism behind the video. They had like the halo around the angels, the shiny suit. I mean, he made that look cool. I can never pull it off.
I can listen to Rock With You and know where I was the first time I heard it at Pegasus.
Wow.
When that song came on, people just stopped in the club.
I can't even imagine.
They just
I can't imagine because I heard it for the first time.
You know, and then slowly, one by one, they got on the dance floor.
Tempo, but it's smooth.
I can't stand him sometimes. He's just
that's
too good.
That's fast. It's hard to make up-tempo music where you can dance, be emotional at the same time.
Most people just get into a groove, so you don't, you know, most of the times you don't get that much of a real song there. So they don't stand up as well as a good storytelling ballad through the years. You want stuff that's gonna have legs, that's gonna hold on. And his up-tempo really does hold on because he really crafted a real song on top of a great groove.
I loop that breathing exercise on working day and night. I loop that for at least a minute before I let that song go. Like, I hold people at bay. Like, I'm holding back, like, 12 pit bulls. Like, you know what's going on. Ah, get him! Ah!
Shit right here.
I'm embarrassed to even say this, but I used to dance by myself to that song.
How is that embarrassing? The song hit. The birth of the hip thrust.
Go
got me working day and night.
You could tell just where he was rhythmically, just by the ones he was writing, really catchy, rhythmic dance songs.
Michael's reference is certainly American R&B and soul and funk, but I also hear Africa in there. And you have to also remember the Jackson 5 toured Africa in the 70s.
Everybody! My dad was there!
It's crazy though. That was just the high water mark of porn life.
There's all these instrumental stretches and breaks in the song that give the musician some shine.
There's the last one.
David had this same sound. Yeah. Had this certain sound
that
like
bites. He bent it. He hit him so hard.
These documentaries got me into guitars. I like the guitars. Hey! Okay, Randy! Multi-talented Randy, bro. The arm strength?
Sometimes he would take it upon himself to bring the rhythm that he wanted, and that really influenced me.
He always had an idea of what he wanted every instrument to sound like, and that's how he recorded.
I love her.
You came in the studio, and he told the guitar player,
he would
sing every part. He didn't play it, but he can sing it. And if you didn't play it like he sang it, he would sing it till you played it like he sang it. God damn it.
He had the vision. Execute the vision. I get that.
I'm never satisfied. I'll cut a track, go back and back and back, and darn it, I should have done this, I should have did it. It's number one on the chart. You're still screaming about what you should have done.
It's evident. When you see somebody's work, you can see the details, and if they actually truly love what they do, if they really do pay attention to the craft.
Perfection was the name of the game. It's about the content of what you do, the quality, the heart, the soul, the love.
I think this generation has just become, the perception has become skewed. The love for the craft becomes secondary to the love of fame and notoriety. My generation,
that's true.
Jordan generation, Bird, Magic, Michael Jackson, they focused on what they love to do.
One of the hidden gems is Get on the Floor, which was co-penned by Louis Johnson.
Get on the Floor!
I don't know if everybody knows this, but you're also a composer. One of my favorites was Michael Jackson, Get on the Floor and Dance.
Originally, that song was created by the bass. I just had that.
In the playgrounds, and I'm dating myself, okay, but you would bring the little radio, or sometimes if you were really tacky, you would bring the little portable record player.
If you were really tacky,
plop it down in the park, drop the needle. So heck yeah.
If you were dancing to that song, more than likely you were going home with somebody, because that's not a song you dance on your own to. You don't dance to Get on the Floor by yourself.
I guess I'm doing it wrong. Hey. Y'all, I think I was sleeping on this song.
Off the Wall is DJ's treat.
Nah, I was sleeping on this song, y'all.
Seems to have been tailor-made for.
I need to go.
You basically
have playlist.
Five songs. The first four songs on side one, and the first song on side two. Off the Wall.
My favorite record on Off the Wall, I like Off the Wall.
Off the Wall's good.
I took a chance with a composer that I have loved his work for a long time, and I could never figure out how he could be from Grimsby, England, living in Worms, Germany, and understand Ain't No Half Steppin', you know, and all of those different terms that he was writing. It was just incredible talent.
He ended up in Germany and being turned on to soul music by a bunch of the Black Army people that were there. Black American soldiers. Mm-hmm. And going, wow, this is a lot more interesting than what I'm doing. And girls come to these shows.
In early Heat Wave, he said, you can hear
my music boring as shit. Let me learn what y'all doing over there.
Progression.
And we recorded Burn This Disco Out, Off the Wall.
That's my number one.
Wow.
That's my number one. Wait, no.
Our temperature did good.
Off the Wall is an example of him bringing that slightly like proggy fusion aspect to it. It's a really unconventional start for a disco record, especially like the title track of an album. It starts with that. It starts on the offbeat, it starts on the two, it has that weird vocal thing in the background.
It kind of feels proggy.
That intro with the kind of ghoulish voices.
Yeah, freaky.
You start to hear that again, of course, on Thriller with the Vincent Price.
Yeah. This is Thriller's auntie or something like. Your body's on your shoulder. Gotta take it up, go act and move it down. And you can't get rid of the feeling. Even the way he like is singing it, it's giving strong Thriller vibes. Girlfriend was on this album, y'all.
London Town album by Paul McCartney.
This album, okay.
Girlfriend.
I don't know why I keep mixing it up for the last album.
I love it. Girlfriend, I'm gonna tell your boyfriend. Yeah. I felt like Michael was singing to me on that one. I did.
If we go out together and a bunch of girls start following me, let's hear what you say to them to make them go away. Get away from him. He's mine, not yours.
What type of show is this?
Same question number two.
Yo, listen, okay? Michael Jackson is mine.
Some of the songs that I sing, my favorite is ballad. I kind of listen to the words, and it's really relating something.
I wrote She's Out of My Life as a result of being very much in love with a wonderful young woman.
That's like
shit.
You
ever get so upset that you're speaking yourself out loud? Well, I was in the car on the Pasadena freeway, and I'm saying, man, she was there for you. She loved you. She wanted to marry you. You're the one who said no. Face it, she's out of your life. Saturday morning, the phone rings, and it's Q, and he says, hey, man, you've been writing. And I played the song, and it's ringing out, and he said, play it again. I played it again. Played it 8 times in a row. And at the end of it, he said, what are you going to do with it? And I said, well, I made a deal with Snuffy yesterday. He's going to do it with Sinatra. And he says, this Q-ism, Sinatra will do it anyway. And I said, okay, Q, then who do you want to do it with? He said, I haven't got a clue. He said, Nan, if you'll trust me, I promise you, an unforgettable recording of this song. And we sat on it for almost 2 years, Mike.
To write a great ballad, first of all, lyrically, the content has to connect. And to me, part of what makes a song connect is that it's personal.
He makes great songs.
But it's
great
also
ballads.
Universal.
Michael Jackson, yes, he's a great entertainer. He was a great dancer. But he was also a great singer. Not a good singer, but a great singer.
I liked his performance on
She's
Out of My Life.
We know.
Really emotional.
The quality of Michael's
voice, I gotta watch that video, y'all.
Was so
incredibly pure.
She's part of my life.
Oh, that's the word for it.
She's out of my life.
Is this the music video here?
And I don't know whether to laugh or cry. I don't know whether to live or die. And it cuts like a knife. She's out of my.
Cried every time that he performed She's Out of My Life, and he would cry too.
Everyone relates She's Out of My Life to Eddie Murphy, right? Anyone who was growing up in the 80s, we saw Delirious first.
That's Michael's hook, his sensitivity. That's what women be saying, Michael's just so sensitive. And they eat that shit up. Mike know too, he be using women in concerts. I seen Mike walk up to girls on the stage being the audience. He said,
can I come down there?
And the women go, ah!
I be eating that shit up like the best meal I ever had.
If you don't scream, Mike will get real sensitive and cry on your ass. If you hear that record, She's Out of My Life, Mike will go,
so I've learned that love's not possession. And I've learned love won't win.
Hold up, Eddie, you can kind of sing. What the heck?
I've learned that love needs expression, but I've learned. And she's out of my life.
Wait, I actually really like this
she's
song.
Out of my life. Down in decision and cursed pride.
It's giving musical though, like, isn't it kind of?
Like,
get it.
Cuts like a knife. She's out of mind.
Ooh, the feeling in that. The feel, and he gonna go cry. Stop, Michael. Ooh, I would have been crying with him. Okay, we have 20 minutes left on the documentary. I think I'll just finish it today. This special must be famous, bro. I always see like funniest clips from
Tito, get me some tissue.
And I had an opportunity to listen to the stems where he's trying different takes. And he actually apologizes for messing the song up.
I'm sorry, I messed it up.
It was amazing because every time he sang it, he cried. And I was trying to figure out what relationship he had, you know, that he could identify with that. So he did it to.
You know what? It's really funny. Because I be hearing some songs, it won't even be the lyrics that get me sometimes because, you know, you don't really hear the specific lyrics. But sometimes it's really like the types of vibe the song be giving you. It'll be a song that it might not even be sad, but it's just the kind of like how you interpret it. I feel like that is what's so sad. He wouldn't even have had to be in a relationship, but maybe it's something like that.
Three times I said, that's the way it's supposed to be. I'm just letting it stay in there.
A lesser producer would have milked it for all it's worth, would milk all that drama for all it's worth. Like, trust me, if Puffy were producing She's Out of My Life, Puffy would have had the whole mark. He would have had Kleenex, like, sponsor the tour.
Bye.
You had people
talking about? Well, what was he crying about? Who was he talking about? Is he talking about Brooke Shields? Is he talking about what girl is he talking about? You know, is he still
Brooke
talking
Shields
about Ben
is
that
so
rat?
Pretty. Seen out I ain't never seen her in nothing, but she's always on Mills, Pinterest. That's what I know.
Tatum O'Neill with Maureen McCormick from the Brady Bunch.
Girls would get together when
the Brady Bunch girls
talking about. You know what I mean? And you would look at the Tiger Beat magazine to look for the gossip and everything. Who made Michael cry?
Why would you think they got the connect?
That I made Michael cry, because I would never make Michael cry.
She's out of my life is, in my opinion, one of the two songs on Off the Wall that there's nothing on Thriller that tops it.
Quiet Storm was huge in the 1970s, which was a kind of radio format of black music that celebrated intimacy and sensuality and ambient softness and quietude. Can't Help It was really the Quiet Storm demographic, right? It was really the kind of late night boudoir romance thing.
It's the first time that you really hear Michael sounding like, to me, sounding like an adult and sounding outside of his R&B thing. It's jazzy.
Suzy Green had started working on it. She was in the Supremes and it also sung with Stevie.
It could have fit on Songs in the Key of Life, really.
That was supposed to be one of the songs on Songs in the Key of Life.
Ooh.
See, I didn't know that. He had the I can't help it if I wanted to, the hook.
Yeah, I think she wrote a lot of the lyrics when we actually were in the studio messing around with it.
That's right.
Can't Help It is my favorite. Stevie overdid it with that song. The nature of the chords are very nocturnal. You know, it doesn't sound like a sunny day to me.
It do. It sounds like nighttime.
You know, a beautiful paradise evening. You know, somewhere untainted by the humans. You know, mystical world. You know, unicorns walking past.
My sister Renee,
he
had been
it.
Hearing me play this cassette. She and Michael were friends. And she took it over to let Michael hear it, and I think it was great that he did it. I mean, really, he did an incredible job.
The melodies are very seductive. They carry some of those signature Stevie lines, but also the signature Stevie chords.
I really believed in the album. First of all, I believe in Michael Jackson.
Stevie Wonder. I love Stevie Wonder.
And being with Stevie Wonder, being in his sessions and just sitting in and learning, just is incredible.
You could put on I Can't Help It right now and I'd still find something that I haven't heard, or it would remind me of something, or the warmth of the bass line would just be like, just kind of wash over you. It's just like, you don't get sick of that music.
I did a record back in 1977. We did It's the Falling in Love. We co-wrote it together, and I know you played on it.
Yep.
I think my record served as a nice
demo.
As a demo.
Patty Austin was a singer in the Quincy Jones arsenal. The very first time that I've heard Patty Austin's voice was It's the Falling in Love.
The thing that really steeps a record in its era and that can make it sound dated is relying heavily on very specific technology of the time. And in the 80s, it was very much about gated reverbs. In the late 70s, you had these like big, massive disco claps.
This album was perhaps maybe one false step away from being a very dated disco record.
Didn't have any of those like tricks or gimmicks. It was pretty much, even though it was immaculately arranged and all the percussive parts and all the way the parts work together, there's nothing other than a bunch of dudes playing the shit out of a song in a room. That will never date.
In a lot of ways, Off the Wall is probably the culmination of classic disco. Came out in August 1979. The Disco Sucks movement started just a month before in July, where Shock DJ Steve Dahl in Chicago gathered a lot of people together at Comiskey Park in Chicago to burn disco records, which is a really, I think, implicitly racist and kind of homophobic
That's so
movement.
Excessive.
People wanted to shift
oh my God.
The dial of popular music back to where they felt comfortable. Right, which was not black, not gay, not Latino.
Burn This Disco Out actually might have been an apt title because it was coming literally at the end of the
you could have been doing anything
disco era,
and you chose to do that.
Just at the edge of being a disco record,
that's
but
so pathetic.
Moving the genre forward.
Far from one of the disco factory music that was just churning out factory beats.
You can feel that kind of visceral energy. I mean, Off the Wall really is like lightning in a bottle. I mean, you really capture Michael Jackson
It do. It's the best track. I don't care what y'all say.
Passion. Best track. That still really comes through on that record.
This is the very last 8-track that my parents brought me before I stopped buying 8-tracks. I remember Off the Wall coming out the second week of August in 1979. Departure.
Wow, it's about to be the second week of August soon.
It's in a person's canon in their career, of which they make a 180 turn from what they were known from.
He was no longer the teeny bopper act. He was no longer the socially shy, awkward, maladjusted guy with acne. He was suddenly exuberant.
Maladjusted guy with acne. That was so unneeded.
His prom picture. He's in a suit and tie and a kind of.
That's his prom picture. It was kind of giving me prom vibes, y'all.
Imagine out on the streets of New York.
Again, life changing. I think sophisticated. I think glamour. I think provocateur. I think, everything that I wanted to be.
Oh, yeah. I'm interested in promotion. I want to do things that's never been done before. If it wasn't for promotion, who would know about the Jackson 5? Who would know that we exist?
That's true.
I would be able to translate my music to different countries. Africa, Japan, New Zealand, Scotland.
Africa's a continent, but I see what he's saying.
The universal core in music that I think transcends even what a crossover's about. Here we view a crossover.
He did do black and white one of the songs,
which we've been faced with for years.
He did it in other language, right?
Even past that, you know, when you get into Argentina and Israel and Spain and Scandinavia and Australia.
I tell people, fashion and music is a universal language. Mm. Wherever you go, you're going to hear the same songs in certain countries. And when people come together for those songs, they're all happy. They're all at peace.
Because a lot of people. Yeah. You speak English when you travel the globe, but they know the song, they know the music, and they know they learn the lyrics somehow. And that's just so wonderful how you can bring people together just through your music.
Michael Jackson can come out on stage and not say anything, and you know that he cares. 100,000 people in Olympic Stadium feel that he's right there for him.
Everyone thinks, you know, like they've had such a personal connection with him, you know, but that's how great he was. He made you feel like that.
Michael just inspired me to be a better person.
I actually do believe that the blessing that the Lord gave this family, the musical blessing, the true mission behind all of that, I believe, is to unify the world together through your music as one. And it's about changing the world for a better place for kids to grow up in.
He had seen what had happened.
All the Jacksons got such great vibes. Like, really.
Jackie Wilson, sometimes the industry wasn't fair to black artists.
I remember fighting in a meeting, you know, like, how come Michael's not on the cover of People magazine? How come he's not on the cover of Us?
Pop radio stations didn't want to play Off the Wall in the beginning.
Publicity lady would tell me, well, if a black person is put on the cover of these magazines, they won't sell.
Michael Jackson is a viable sell like artist crazy. All by himself. Stop. And if they gave him the opportunity, he could win the radio stations over.
It's just not going to sell to the people like this y'all cater to.
Where we are is where we always were, and we weren't. They're kids that like were born when Obama was in office, so they don't understand a world where like there was a white president. They don't even know what that feels like. I didn't know what it felt like to not have like black pop artists, because he made us feel and believe that that was just the norm. He took black music to a place where it became human music.
Music has no color, and it shouldn't have color. And I don't believe in that. What I do, I don't want it labeled black or white. I want it labeled. It's music.
It was a simpler time, and radio had everything to do with it. Hey, let's go out with some up-tempo first, get ourselves positioned, bang, and we'll come in with that ballad, and, you know, you go gold, you go platinum. Mm-hmm.
4 singles and the top 10 in Billboard, not counting it being number 1 on R&B radio station. It had never been done before.
Some people looked at it as a disco album, which in retrospect is kind of foolish, because it's one of the most creatively influential albums in history.
You look back at the awards for Off the Wall, they're R&B awards.
The music industry is still very segregated at the time, and Michael was only nominated for R&B awards, and he won.
Of course, it still happens today. They literally gave Doja Cat a freaking R&B award. I'm sitting here like, she don't even do R&B like that. She do pop. She's a pop artist.
That is my message.
She a rapper, but she does pop.
He thought they snuffed her.
But they still gonna put her in R&B. He said, ain't nothing changed.
Next year, they're gonna have to give it to me.
And that was Thriller, huh?
That's right.
Off the Wall really
Thriller, they did give it to
kind of set the blueprint for R&B. And I think most artists today
acknowledge that.
It's hard to come up with something fresh and new all the time. They go back and they say, what was great? What was done that was just great? And they find themselves listening to Off the Wall. Mm-hmm. And then they take a little piece and they say, see how he did this? We gotta do that. See how they made this sound? We gotta do that. I do that, so I know.
That album, hear it in music all the time. Pharrell to Justin Timberlake.
My music would not be here if it weren't for his influence Off the Wall.
I can hear it. I can hear it in Pharrell. Well.
Like, I wouldn't have music.
I don't think there's any way there's any other record that I played more music from, like, in the course of 20 years of DJing. 10 to 15,000 times, like, I have released the vinyl on those songs.
Off the Wall is the album I still play to this day. It's the album that I put on when I want to teach my daughter how to dance.
It was soul music's epoch of magic realism. And when I say magic realism, I mean it was transformative. It takes you someplace else.
It's so rich musically. The arrangements, the singing, the background vocals.
Michael taught me melodies king. He was like, babies don't sing lyrics, they hum melody. A, B, C, D, E, F, G. They may not know all the letters in the alphabet, but they know that melody to that song.
That was the way I saw music. I always saw music as like these portals. It's like you listen to a song, okay, it's gonna take you into this land every time.
In its first year alone, that album sold over 6 million copies. It's been overshadowed Ooh. Because of the Thriller album.
There would be no Thriller.
Oh yeah, that's insane, bro. No one now could do Thriller, those numbers.
He was intent, no actually one. Intent like, on making the biggest album.
Let me pause. Because no one now could do those numbers at all. Like, they depend so much on like the force of the music label behind them. I'm not gonna name any labels or anything, but y'all know who I'm talking about when I'm like, they put so much money into putting them in every mall, every radio station, every this and that, putting them all over TikTok, pushing them there, that the song seems way bigger than it actually is. And then you see the numbers when like the album comes out and you're looking at it like, how did this not even sell 100k units? That doesn't make any sense, you know? So it's like they're faking a lot of streams, a lot of numbers to seem bigger than they are, because now they can do something like that. Yeah.
History.
And the amazing thing is that he actually did.
Whatever your top game was, you going on top of that one. That was his gift.
You're dealing with a true artist devoted to the art, and everything else is secondary.
I think it's very easy for people to sidetrack and talk about this complexion and focus on what this man was and how he was that, and how you can learn from that. You approach things the way he approached music.
You gotta look at the person who did it best and follow them. It's just common sense.
Does that hurt? No.
Wait.
It doesn't.
Pause. 10 seconds. I didn't hear.
You will be phenomenal.
And the idea of being separated from your brothers, does that hurt? No, it doesn't. Because there's other kinds of sounds of music that I'd love to do. It hurts what is inside of me and it can't get out and it's hidden from the world. When I do those solo albums and I'm doing all kinds of different music, it's wonderful. I feel like I'm accomplishing what I'm supposed to do. And you don't feel guilty or worried about your brothers? No, because they understand. Why hide something? Why hide it? Share it.
Off the Wall will live forever. Yeah. That was 1979, but this is just the beginning for that record. It's just the beginning, and new people will explore and discover it today and tomorrow, and it'll be something new to them today and tomorrow. It's just the beginning.
Literally, that's what happened to me.
Sexual barriers, racial barriers. He brought everybody, I mean, say everybody, and old people, young people, gays, straights. You, I mean, wherever you went, there was a smile.
But the beauty of his artistry and what he has left us with so much joy and like so much thankfulness for all that he had given to me, you know, given to everybody. But I'm just gonna be selfish here for a moment. what he gave to me, and I'm glad that I found that joy again. And I think that in that way, his spirit is still with me.
He surpassed what I ever expected of him. I expected a great deal of him, and he surpassed that.
There's an element of God that's in people. Some people, God laid his hand on longer and held it there.
Secretly and privately, there's deep, okay. I mean, really deep within, there's a destiny. And just for me to stay on that track and follow it, I really believe and feel I'm here for a reason. And that's my job, you know, to perform for the people. And if they accept it, that I'm rewarded. They want to put me up on that pedestal, I feel even better.
Do you ever want to stop?
No, don't stop till you get enough.
And you haven't had enough.
No way. No way.
Don't stop till you get enough. Don't stop till you get enough.
Wow, that was such a great documentary. I feel like it was a great introduction into how he started out as Jackson 5, starting out with his family, just learning about how he grew up and learned about the business to when he was working on Off the Wall. I didn't realize how big Off the Wall was, but bro, like it's how it, like, I like the guy. He was like, you know, a lot of records in those times, like in any period, really, they sound dated. They can sound so dated. I was literally listening to Katy Perry's song. Why does it sound so old? Like, it sounds so dated. It doesn't even sound good like that. And I'm wondering why this record doesn't sound as amazing as it did when I first heard it. And it's because it has such a sound of that time that was so distinct to that time that my ears are just not accepting it. But I can listen to Off the Wall and I can be like, this feels new. This feels so clear and it feels so like classic and timeless. Like I could listen to it 20 years from now and I'm still gonna feel like this doesn't feel old at all. Thank you guys so much for watching. And I'm gonna be listening to the Dangerous album tomorrow and I'll have it out this Friday. So Patreon, if I'm not able to put on YouTube, it should be on Patreon Friday. And then for YouTube, I'll try to provide a link, y'all. Thank you guys so much. Bye.